Hello everyone, welcome back to the course of software engineering. This video is brought to you by Newton's group of institutions in association with Redefined Solutions. This is Arvind Egireddy from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, CEO Redefined Solutions. In this video, we will discuss about scenario based modeling, UML models that supplement the use cases and data modeling concepts. In our previous video, we have discussed about requirement analysis, overall objectives and philosophy, analysis rule of thumb, requirement modeling approaches. So the link of that particular video is given in the description. Please go through it if you have not seen it before. Now, in this session, we will discuss about scenario-based modeling, creating preliminary use cases, refining a preliminary use case, and writing a formal use case. Then we will discuss about UML models that supplement the use cases, developing an activity diagram, and developing a swim lane diagram. And the third topic for today, what we will discuss is data modeling concepts. We discuss about data objects, data attributes, and relationships. So in our next video, we will discuss about class-based modeling. So now coming to scenario-based modeling. So although the success of a computer-based systems or product is measured in many ways, user satisfaction resides at the top of the list. If we understand how the end users want to interact with a system, our software team will be better able to properly characterize the requirements and build meaningful analysis and design models. Hence, requirement modeling with UML begins with the creation of scenarios in the form of use cases, activity diagrams, and swim lane diagrams. Now, creating a preliminary use case, that is the first topic. So here, the use case describes a specific usage scenario in straightforward language from the point of view of a defined actor. But how do you know that what to write about and how much to write about it? How detailed to make your description and how to organize the description? So these are the questions that must be answered if use cases are to provide value as a requirements modeling tool. So what to write about? The first two requirement engineering tasks, that is inception and elicitation, they provide us with the information we will need to begin writing use cases. So here, requirement gathering meeting, QFD, and other requirement engineering mechanisms are used to identify the stakeholders and define the scope of the problem, specify overall operational goals, establish priorities, and to outline all the known functional requirements and to describe the things that will be manipulated by the system. So to begin developing a set of use cases, we need to list the functionalities or activities performed by the specific actor. Here we can obtain these from a list of required system functions through conversations with the stakeholders or by evaluation of activity diagrams that are being developed as part of the requirements modeling. Now we will develop the use case in practice with an example. So this figure shows an example of the scenario model. So in which the functions of a banking system are decomposed graphically into multiple levels of scenario groups, scenarios, and sub-scenarios. So here we have scenario groups, scenarios, and sub-scenarios. For our convenience, we have represented them with three different colors. So scenario groups with the dark maroon color, scenarios with white color, and sub-scenarios with the black color. Now coming to scenarios. So here we say that the scenarios are with the white color. So S11 and S12, what we can see here. So here S11 and S12 is a specified semi-formally using a template definition. So coming to the scenario groups. So here in scenario groups, we represent in maroon color. So here scenario can be grouped hierarchically into multiple levels of scenario groups. For example, the scenarios S11 and S12 are arranged into scenario group SG1, which is further grouped with SG2 and SG3 into a supergroup S0, SG0, that is a banking transactions. So here the overall functions of the systems are first divided into distinct features represented by high level scenario groups, which can be decomposed level by level into subgroups until the basics of the scenarios are identified. So here a scenario group can be defined using the same template as scenario definition. In practice, the developers can defer the filling of the attributes of a group into its child scenarios. So, and the definition of the scenario group should be consistent with the specification of its children. Now coming to sub scenarios, we have represented with the black color. So scenarios may share some functionalities provided by commonly used software components. For example, authentication is represented for all banking transactions. Sub scenarios decompose a scenario into relatively independent functional parts. For example, scenario smallest 3-1 is decomposed into sub scenario smallest 3-1-1, smallest 3-1-2, and smallest 3-1-3, that is with the black color. So here the sub scenarios are identified with an insight into system high level designs, such as decomposed by layers, decomposed by tiers, decomposed by configuration, and decomposed by service providers. Now let us see scenario relationships. So here scenarios may relate to each other with respect to their execution path. So here the those execution path is path contained. So here the execution path of scenario can be part of the path of an another path. Next, path identical. So here two scenarios have the same path. In this case, they may share a certain set of attributes such as conditions. Next, path independent. Two scenarios are said to be path independent if they have completely different path without any overlaps. So here scenarios may also related to with each other with respect to the conditions, and typically these conditions relationships are independent. First one. So two conditions are independent if one can happen regardless of the other. Trigger or trigger by. So one condition may trigger the other condition to activate. Mutually exclusive. So two conditions are mutually exclusive if they cannot exist at the same time and related. So we say two conditions are related to each other if they are used in the same scenario or they are mutually exclusive. So here such relationships can assist in risk analysis. So a scenario may be risky if it contains the software components who has a high probability of fail or whose failure may cause serious consequences. Or second, it has a condition that has a high probability of failure or whose failure can cause a serious consequence. Third, it locates on the path that conveys more software components. So relational analysis can facilitate the validation of complex scenarios. It can also help for dependency analysis such as execution dependency and condition dependency and regression testing. Now coming to the next topic, that is scenario dependencies. So dependency analysis is important for the system change management. So in this model, scenarios are dependent in three ways. One is functional dependency. So scenarios are functionally dependent if they belong to the same scenario group in which the scenarios represent the common function from different aspects, or they contain the same sub scenarios in which the relay on the same service. Now the second is data dependency. So here the scenarios are data dependent with respect to their template definition. So these scenarios are input dependent if they are triggered by the same data event and actions. They are output dependent if they produce the same result such as output data and products. They are execution dependent if they cover common software components such as code, module, and interfaces. They are condition dependent if they are affected by the same conditions, and they are reference dependent if they reference to the common software artifacts such as a document, code, and persistent data. Now, the third is a control dependency. So here, two scenarios are control dependent if they are involved in the precedent or successor relationships as defined in the template. Now, coming to completeness and consistency check. So here, to avoid the conflicts, duplications, and omissions, some generic CNC rules are to be followed. The first one is scenario groups are mutually exclusive. This is the first rule. That is, for any pair of distinct scenario groups G and G dash, if a scenario S belongs to G, then S must not belong to G dash. Okay, so the second one is there are no duplicate scenarios. That is, for any two scenarios, S and S dash, they differ on at least one of the attributes of inputs, outputs, and execution path. And the third one is, there are no overlapping functionalities between sub-scenarios within the same parent scenario. That is, each sub-scenario represents a separate path of the overall functional. Next, fourth one is, for each scenario, we need to identify expected system behavior with normal inputs. At least two corresponding scenarios exist in identifying the behavior under abnormal inputs and the exceptional conditions respectively. Now, coming to the second point, that is refining a preliminary use case. So here, a description of alternative interactions is essential for a complete understanding of the functions that is being described by the use cases. Therefore, each step is the primary scenario, which is evaluated by asking the following questions. Can the actor take some other action at this time? That is the first question. Second question is it possible that the actor will encounter some error condition at that point? If so, what it be? And the third question is it possible that the actor will encounter some other behavior at this point? If so, what it be? So the answers to these questions result in the creation of set of secondary scenarios that are part of the original use cases but represent alternative behavior. So for my first question, that is, can the actor take some other action at this point? The answer is yes. My second question, is it possible that the actors will encounter some error condition at this point? So any number of error conditions can occur as a computer-based system operates. So here also the answer is yes. My third question is it possible that the actors will encounter some other behavior at this point? So that was my third question. So again, the answer to this question is yes. So here, in addition to the three generic questions suggested, the following issues also must be explored. That is, are there cases in which some validation functions occur during the use case? This implies that validation function is invoked and potential error conditions may occur. Are there cases in which the supporting function or actor will fail to respond appropriately? For example, a user action awaits a response, but the function that is to respond is times out. Or can the poor system performance result in unexpected or improper user actions? Now coming to my third point, that is writing a formal use case. So sufficient, the informal use cases present some times sufficient for requirement modeling. So however, when we use case involves a critical activity or describes a complex set of steps with a significant number of expectations, a formal approach may be described. So in many cases, there is no need to create a graphical representation of the usage scenario. However, diagrammatic representation can facilitate the understanding, particularly when the scenario is complex. So, like any other form of written descriptions, a use case is only as good as its authors. So, if the description is unclear, then the use case can be misleading or it can become ambiguous. So, a use case basically focuses on the functional and behavioral requirements. So, however, here the scenario-based modeling is appropriate for a significant majority of all the situations that we'll encounter as a software engineer. So, if developed properly, the use case can provide substantial benefits as a modeling tool. Now, coming to the next topic, that is UML models that supplement the use cases. So here, a broad area of UML graphical models are followed, that is developing the activity diagram. So here, the UML activity diagram supplements the use case by providing a graphical representation of the flow of interaction within the specific scenario, similar to the flowchart. An activity diagram uses rounded rectangles to inform a specific system function, arrows to represent the flow through the system, decisions for diamonds to depict a branching decision, and solid horizontal lines to indicate that parallel activities are occupied. So an activity diagram for the use cases, we will see in the next sessions, next videos. So here the activity diagram is something which is like our flowchart, what we have discussed in our C programming. So now coming to the swimlane diagrams. So the UML swimlane diagram is a useful variation of the activity diagram and allows us to represent the flow of activities described by the use cases, and at the same time indicate which actor or analysis class has responsibility for the actions that are being described by the activity rectangle. So here the responsibilities are represented as parallel segments that divide the diagram vertically like a lanes in the swimming pool. Okay, now coming to another topic, that is data modeling concepts. So in software requirement, if software requirement includes the need to create, extend, or interface with a database, or if complex data structures must be constructed and manipulated. So here the software team may choose to create a data model as part of the overall requirement modeling. A software engineer or analyst defines all the data objects that are processed within the system. The relationship between the data objects and other information that is pertain to the relationships. So here the entity relationship diagram, ERD, addresses these issues and represent all the data objects that are entered, stored, transformed, and produced within the application. Now coming to the first, that is the data objects. So here a data object is a representation of the composite information that must be understood by the software. Therefore, width, a single value would not be a valid data object, but dimensions incorporating like height, width, and depth could be defined as an object. So a data object can be an external entity, or it can be a thing, or an occurrence, or an event, or a role, or an organizational unit, or a place, or a structure. So here, the description of the data object incorporates the data object and all of its attributes. So here the data object encapsulates data only, there is no reference within the data object to operate that can that act on the data. Now coming to data attributes. So here the data attributes, they define the properties of the data object and take on one of the three different characteristics. They can be used to name an instance of the data object, or they can be used to describe the instance, or to make the references to another instance in an other table. So in addition, one or more of the attributes must be defined as an identifier. That is, the identifier attribute which becomes a key when we want to find an instance of the data object. And in some cases, values for the identifiers are unique, although this is not a requirement. Now coming to third, that is relationships. So here data objects are connected to one another in different ways. Now for suppose, consider the two data objects, person and car. So these objects can be represented using a simple notation as illustrated in the figure. So here the connection is established between the person and the car because the two objects are related. But what are the relationships? So to determine the answer, we should understand the role of the people, so, and the cars within the context of the software to be built. So we can establish a set of object relationship pairs that define the relevant relationship. For example, a person owns a car. A person is insured to drive a car. Here, the relationship owns and insured to drive define the relevant connections between the person and the car. So in this figure, which illustrate these object relationships graphically, and the arrows noted in this figure provide important information about the directionality of the relationship and often reduce ambiguity or misinterpretations. Thanks for listening to my video. If you like this video, please subscribe to my channel and press the bell icon for the latest notifications. Thank you, one and all.